You're watching an encore presentation of Wind Tunnel with Dave Despain on Speed Channel. No phone calls, please.
Hi, oh, we're on. Hi, I'm Dave Despain. Tonight on Wind Tunnel, it's a live TV show. We have an interesting guest lineup, particularly for those of you who like learning new stuff, new racing stuff, rather than just arguing about the same old racing stuff, which is what we do here most of the time. If you've heard the buzz about the hottest motocross talent to come out of Florida since Ricky Carmichael, we got him tonight. If you've heard the buzz about this young black racer rumored to have been offered a 10-year NASCAR contract, we got him too. Actually, it's the same guy, James Bubba Stewart. Interesting story. And we're going to introduce you to Speedway bike racer Greg Hancock. His racing schedule makes the Nextel Cup and the World of Outlaw guys look like a bunch of slackers in comparison. It'll be an interesting conversation. Steve Wallace is going to be on the phone tonight. Sure, he's Rusty's son, but he's a racer in his own right. He's heading for Bristol this weekend for an event that you may not know about. Should be pretty interesting. Call now if you want to talk to Bubba. 866-W-TUNNEL. That's 866-988-663. Or email us via the link at speedtv.com. We'll have Hancock a little later, unless our technical things that are going on cause us to flip-flop those guys. We don't know yet if that's going to happen. It's always part of the adventure. Mostly, though, we kick things off here on this show with a little threesome tonight. A preview of the weekend races called Hot Topics. Round two of the chase for the Nextel Cup, Sunday, Monster Mile, Dover, Delaware. That would be a home race for Jeff Gordon. DuPont Corporate Headquarters just down the road. Jeff's a four-time winner here, third in the points, nine behind the co-leaders, Kurt Busch, and guess who? Dale Earnhardt Jr. It is the first ever Grand Prix of China this weekend on a new 14-turn circuit in Shanghai that you'll see for the first time here in just a few hours. It's the first race back, meantime, for Ralf Schumacher since his injurious crash at the U.S. Grand Prix in June. And first appearance this year for Jacques Villeneuve. He replaces Jarno Trulli on Team Renault. Some debate how many seats there are in this joint, but we hear they're all sold. Petit Le Mans, that would be Road Atlanta's miniature version of the French sports car classic. That runs for 10 hours or 1,000 miles, whichever comes first, starting at noon Eastern on Saturday. Last year's winners, the champion Audi team, have already locked up this year's title. And oh, by the way, last night Frank Cozzi won the last race in the big Wednesday night series at New Egypt Speedway in New Jersey. 10 guys went into the deal, covered by 22 championship points. Brian Godown finished third in the race and thus claimed the $17,500 champion's bonus. Kenny Schrader made the main, the real main, not some exhibition main, after riding up to New Jersey from Charlotte on his Suzuki. You go, Schrader. Let's go to the telephones. I got Sebi in Watertown, Connecticut. Sebi, welcome to the show. What's on your mind?
Hey, Dave. How are you?
Good, man.
Hey, listen, I think NASCAR and Nextel need to get together. They've been on this big media blitz through New York and everything,
sure,
which was almost as bad as Casey Mears there doing that soap opera stunt.
on the soap opera?
Yeah.
You thought it was that painful? That's pretty painful. All right, anyway.
Listen, I know a way that they could expose new fans to NASCAR.
Okay.
A spread in Playgirl magazine.
yeah, exactly. Not perhaps the family image that the France family are looking for, but hey, then again, it's that new market, that new audience, right?
That's all they're after right now, it seems like, is new markets, and I think that's one that's out there that needs to be conquered.
Is Playboy, Playgirl still in business?
I don't know.
I haven't read it lately.
I've never seen one myself personally, Dave. But,
so you're not just making this up, are you, Sammy?
No. Well, right. Listen, if you get credit, all I want is a bobblehead.
We'll run that down. Give the guy a bobblehead. We didn't give away a bobbler last night, and it'd be fun to kind of picture those guys and just try to figure out which one. Well, never mind about that. Go ahead. Give him the bobblehead. We got to move on here. Sebi, thanks for the phone call. Yeah, there it is. Did I come from? That's the Playgirl magazine bobblehead. Bonus. With that, we get to the email that kicks off the evening. Dave, last night you made it sound like Las Vegas was the first time two major series raced on the same card. Well, back in the 70s, my dad and I loved going to Michigan International Speedway, where they ran a 200-mile USAC IndyCar race followed by a 200-mile USAC stock car race. Indeed, they did. It was neat to see A.J. Foyt get out of his IndyCar and jump into his stock car. Bet nobody does that this weekend, says Brian Pease in Naples, Florida. Actually, all I said was that the trucks and the champ cars have never shared the same day, Brian, but you are spot on. Back when men was men and racing was a lot less specialized and I think maybe more entertaining as a result, the crossover stuff was commonplace. A twin bill like Michigan made it a snap. Who would I like to see cross over this weekend? Well, let's see. How about Carl Edwards jumping out of his pickup truck or jumping off of his pickup truck after winning and then going and getting in the champ car, and Sebastian Bourdais? How about the frog guy? What do they call him? Who's a frog? Kermit. How about Kermit warming up for the open wheel race with a bunch of laps in a pickup truck? That might be kind of fun. Let's look ahead to the rest of the hour here. Coming up on Wind Tunnel, we've got Speedway 101. It is a primer on this spectacular broad sliding support sport with the past world and defending national champ Greg Hancock. Got these late model guys looking forward to a career moment this weekend, the opportunity to race at the famed Bristol Motor Speedway, and Rusty Wallace's son Steve among them. We'll talk to him shortly. How much truth is there to the rumor that motocross superstar Bubba Stewart is headed for a car racing career? We're going to ask him about that and a whole lot more when he joins us shortly.
Wind Tunnel with Dave Despain is brought to you by Miller High Life. To live simply, proudly, boldly, manly. This is The High Life.
Speedway motorcycle racing is a tiny blip on the American motorsports radar, but in Europe it is a hugely popular form of racing, and thus the top American riders spend most of their lives on the continent, starring in a league system for which the closest U.S. comparison is perhaps football, baseball, or basketball. And they chase their very own world championship. My next guest is Greg Hancock. Now would be the time to call if you'd like to talk to a young man who has won a total of 10 European League and World Championships, including the most prestigious world individual title. And tomorrow night at the Gold Country Fairgrounds in Auburn, California, he's going after his sixth AMA U.S. Championship. Greg, welcome to Wind Tunnel, and right off the bat, congratulations. You're a newlywed, I understand.
That's right. Thanks a lot. It's good to be on the show, and yeah, I am a newlywed and feeling very good about it.
Your wife is Swedish, I understand. You race for a team in the Swedish League, also a team in the Polish League, also a team in the British League, and I suspect rank-and-file American fans probably have no idea what we're talking about. Help us to understand in simple terms what these leagues are and how you race three of them at the same time. Your life must be fairly complicated.
Ah, you know what? It can be complicated. It takes a lot of organization, and basically, it's Speedway is put together in Europe, kind of like you said earlier about different types of league racing, basketball, football, soccer, things like that. I have a league. I'm employed to ride for a team in Sweden, a team in England, and a team in Poland. And basically, I go there and compete against another team, as you would see in football and things like that. Competing one day on Sundays in Poland. On Tuesdays, I travel to to Sweden for a league match there. And then any day in between, really, we can be competing somewhere in England as the league runs many more races there. So in a nutshell, that's kind of how it is. And then we travel around the rest of Europe competing in the World Championship,
Championship. So you have three individual race teams in three different countries, each of which races one night a week. And the NASCAR guys complained about doing 36 in a whole season. let's cover some more of the basics. The Speedway racing bike itself. Where does it come from? What does it weigh? How much horsepower? That kind of stuff. Because it's not the kind of thing you go down and see at your Honda dealer.
That's right. You can't find something like that just anywhere. The bikes are kind of a basic. The most long-lasting bike you would hear of today is a Jawa bike, and those bikes are actually they manufacture a complete Speedway bike that you can buy ready to go. But
who used to make the Czech motocrossers, right? Same company?
Exactly, Jawa and Esso and the company like that. Okay. They still manufacture some of those bikes in the Czech Republic. So.
Okay.
And for me, I'm using a chassis that's made in the Czech Republic, actually in the same town where Jawa factory is. And then I use an engine that's made, a GM engine, which is made in Italy. So my bike is more or less put together more in specific parts, parts that I like, a little bit more higher performance type stuff.
How much horsepower? 500 cc's making what?
Yeah, 500 cc. We're putting out about 60 horsepower on the back wheel. They run on methanol, alcohol fuel, and no brakes, of course.
190 pounds? Maybe.
Yeah, even less than that. They're exactly about 80 kilos.
Why no brakes?
Good question. It's always been that way. I think the way Speedway is and the broad sliding, you would you'd be in trouble if you had brakes on it. If you put the brakes on one of these, you'd end up probably sending yourself through the fence a lot more than we already do.
When you want to slow it down, you just get it a little more sideways, right?
Exactly. If you want it, the only way to slow down is to break the thing into more of a slide. Otherwise, what we're trying to do on the big tracks in Europe is you're trying to keep the wheels in line and keep the thing tracking to keep your speed and not scrub off too much speed.
So how many Americans are in the same situation? How many American Speedway kids are over there now racing in Europe, because that's where they have to go to make a living?
You know what? All in all, there's about seven of us. At this time, there's only, and it's dwindled a little bit over the years. It's been a lack of junior speedway hasn't sort of followed through like it did when we were kids. Mm-hmm. But it's on the comeback trail now, and we are a minority over there in Europe. But when we come to fly the flag, you know, it doesn't matter how few we are, we can still make a lot of noise.
Okay, we'll get to the American scene in a minute, but first, give me some sense of how popular this is in Europe. I remember so vividly the video of Bruce Penhall, who was the first American in however many 50 years since Milne, I guess, in the 30s, to win a championship, a sellout crowd, the famed Wembley Stadium in England. Is it still a very big deal over there, and especially so in the Eastern European countries?
Yeah, exactly. It's huge. I mean, you can't even compare it to the speedway that you would see in America, and it's probably the lack of speedway these days. But it is isn't coming up better in California and across New York and even in Indianapolis. So that's good. But in Europe, it's a whole other ball game. You know, we're averaging in Poland, we get between 10 and 15,000 people on a regular basis just for a league match. And for the World Championship, they're getting up to 30 and 40,000 just to come and watch an event, in the big cities all around Europe. So it's you can't compare it to what you see here in America.
And real quick, let's complete the international tour talking about Poland. You had a tough race there over the weekend, next to last round of the World Championship, and the local guy won it, and you didn't, and you needed to. So give me the short version of what happened.
I floundered.
I understand that feeling.
You know what? I had the ultimate opportunity to capitalize and chase the world championship. I was only about 16 points down from the leader at that stage, and I needed everything to go my way, and it really didn't. We made a vital mistake on the setup to the engine for race day. The track was quite a bit different from what it was set up in practice, and we were ready to go. And if anything, my practice was too good, and I went into the race so full of confidence that I didn't make the starts and didn't perform the way that I should have. But I live and learn, and I still got years to come, and I've been in the world championship. I've been the world champion, and I know what it takes. I'll stay there.
Third in the world this year, still with a shot at second, so it's still not bad. I need a break on that point. Then we're going to come back. We're going to talk about Speedway in America. I've got phone calls, got emails. We're talking with Greg Hancock, and we'll talk about tomorrow night's National at Auburn, California. All right, we're back, and we're talking about the world of speedway racing with Mr. Hancock. And I'm curious, you mentioned New York, Indianapolis. There are these little pockets of speedway enthusiasm. It's been a Southern California thing for a long time. They've tried to export it to various places. For some reason, Owego, New York adopted it, and it's been going on out there for years. Why has it been such a tough deal to get the thing to take root elsewhere in America? Do you have a theory about that?
You know what? All I can say is, I mean, America, we're such a big country, and we're so dominated by the traditional sports, you know, from the footballs and the baseball, basketball, etc. And then in motorsport, you know, NASCAR racing is huge, Indy cars, and of course nowadays, I mean, motocross is just exploded. It's incredible. So it's really hard. Speedway has always been a small sport, but fortunately, we've had some great riders that have kept the sport alive. And you know, now you talk about Owego, New York, and the promoter there, Jason Bonsignor. He's a former NHL hockey player, still playing actively now, and that guy has a huge love for Speedway, and we need, you know, more people like him to help us keep the sport alive.
The video we were watching there was you winning the U.S. Championship in 2000. You won it again last year on the same track. That's the fairgrounds up in Auburn, California, and you go there tomorrow night under a fair bit of pressure. You've come back from Europe to chasing the World Championship to do this race, which is actually the third in a series. And just how tight is it for the championship? It's a point deal. What do you got to do tomorrow night to win it?
Got to win it.
That's what I thought.
I'm going to win it. You know, it's only 1 point separating me and Billy Gennaro, and then 1 point down again to another familiar name, Billy Hamill. So we are going up there to Auburn. I mean, the Fast Friday Speedway there, it's kind of the best. It's really the best track in the country right now, and the promoter there does a great job. And I think it's going to be an exciting event. It'll be a full house crowd, and it's a great speedway track, fast, and it's always good racing. So you can't count anybody out.
And you come from what I guess would be called the birthplace of Speedway talent in America, perhaps, Orange County Speedway down there in Costa Mesa. It's been around for a long time. It's a great success story. Is that, in fact, where you cut your teeth? And again, what is it about this? Here we're seeing it. What is it about this little bull ring that has made that such a bastion of Speedway for so many years?
You know, that really was the spinal cord of Speedway for so long. Harry Oxley was the promoter there, and he kept that place alive, and it's still going today. And for me, yeah, that's where I got my career started off in junior Speedway, and back in like 1978, 79, and it's just carried on from there. It's always been a focal point of Costa Mesa Speedway, and these days it's a shame because there's a clash of the federations. The AMA has sanctions one side of it, and up in Auburn, and unfortunately it's a separate association in Costa Mesa. So the sport's too small. It's a real shame that it has to be broken up like that, but we really need to stick together and try to keep the thing to survive and build and make it a bigger sport like it was when I was a kid.
You've been doing this a long time, won a lot of championships. How much longer do you want to do it? What are the plums you still want to pick out there? What do you still want to accomplish before you hang up your helmet?
You know what? I still want to win the world championship. And, I got to say it. I hope Mike Bass, the seven-time national champion, is watching, because I'm chasing his seven titles. But I still got a couple years to go.
You're getting close, too. Tomorrow night, you got to go win the race to do it.
That's right.
We wish you luck. We hope you have a great night. Have a good finish to the world championship. And we'll be looking forward to following your accumulation of future titles, including, we hope, that second world individual. Thanks a lot for spending time with us tonight.
Hey, thanks a lot, Dave.
That's Greg Hancock, ladies and gentlemen, the national championship final tomorrow night in Auburn. We're going to talk to Steve Wallace next, and we still have Bubba Stewart coming up, so it's a big night on the wind tunnel. Don't go anywhere. We're just getting rolling here. Hey, we all know Bristol Motor Speedway for its twice-a-year NASCAR excitement, but it doesn't just sit idle the other 50 weekends. A few years back, they covered the concrete oval with dirt for a War of Outlaw and a late model show. That turned out to be a one-shot deal. Just last month, the Hooters Pro Cup Series presented another division with the opportunity to give the half mile a whirl. And this weekend, the United Auto Racing Association will give its drivers a chance to star on a very big stage, the High Bank of Bristol. UARA is a Southeastern Traveling Pavement Late Model Series, kind of local racing that Wind Tunnel tries to support, and this is a very big weekend for those guys, one of whom just happens to be on the telephone. Steve Wallace's dad, Rusty, won his first big NASCAR race at Bristol, calls it his favorite track. Steve is a UARA regular and will be back at Bristol this weekend. Steve, welcome to Wind Tunnel. You know, it's only a matter of time till guys like me stop referring to you as Rusty's son.
Okay, yeah, so, man, I appreciate
so just be
having...
patient. Good to have you here. Let's take this a step at a time. I said you're going back to Bristol, unlike most of the guys you'll be racing this weekend, who will be going there for the first time. Tell me about the big hit you had there in the Hooters Pro Cup race, if you remember it. That was ugly.
Yeah, man, I hit the wall, you know, head on about 130 mile an hour in the Hooters Pro Cup race. We got a little bit loose off turn two, and I just lost it. You know, dang, chased it all the way down the backstretch, and just time he drove head on the wall, knocked the windshield out, and tore the motor up in it and everything.
Yeah, that was big and that was bad, and we won't be seeing anything like that this weekend, we hope. Let's go back to the UARA car. What's the big difference? What's going to be the key to winning this deal?
Well, like my dad said, you know, I think the big key to Bristol is, you know, just keeping it on the bottom, driving straight up off the corner. I think the Hooters Pro Cup Series helped me out, you know, because I got, you know, I think probably got about 100 laps of practice and, you know, 150 more laps of race time around this place than these guys do. And I think, you know, I think probably, you know, a lot more experience than these guys have. So.
Are they all going to come to you and say, Steve, give me a hand here. Tell me how to set this thing up. Tell me what I need to do. And if so, are you going to help them? Is it that kind of series? You guys all buddies, or are you pretty fierce competitors?
Yeah. Like, I got about three or four good buddies. I got Jason York, my buddy Jamie Elton, you know. But I'm going to, you know, like I'm going to try and keep it myself. I really want this win bad. You know, we've had three wins locked up this year, and I've had some late race incidents, you know. But I don't plan on helping them all, you know.
I just want to win this deal. You're seventh in points, and that would help you climb the ladder a little bit. Tell me about the plan from here. What are you going to be doing the rest of this year, next year? What's the career path? How far out do you and your dad have it planned?
Well, for the next 2 years, we're going to build, I think we're in the Hooters Pro Cup Series full time next year. We're going to sell all my late model equipment, and we're going to run that for the next 2 years, and it's just all from there. From then, you know, hopefully I can get in the Busch car, you know, after that.
Well, man, we wish you luck. We appreciate you calling in tonight. I hope things go very well for you at Bristol this weekend, and give our regards to all your UARA counterparts. Tell them the wind tunnel guys will be pulling for them this weekend.
Well, all right, Dave. I appreciate it.
All right, Steve. Thank you very much. And with that, we're going to keep on trucking. My next guest is standing by, I hope. We'll find out if he can hear us all the way out in San Diego, California. There he is, Bubba Stewart. Big smile and a big wave. Yes, he can hear us. We will talk to him, and you can call right after this. My next guest has been a professional racer for just 3 years, but he has created quite a stir in that time, and I sense that the stirring probably is just beginning. Before he turned 16, motocross star James Bubba Stewart broke Ricky Carmichael's longstanding record for amateur national championships. He turned pro in 2002. And since doing so, has nailed down four titles, two each in the AMA Chevy Trucks 125 National and the THQ Regional Supercross Series. Armed with a new Kawasaki contract, he's about to take on that guy right there. There's Bubba and Ricky together. Next year in the 250 class in 05, they will finally meet head-to-head. Carmichael, the challenge for Bubba Stewart as he moves into the next phase of his racing career. And Bubba joins us now live from the Hilton Gas Gas Lamp in San Diego, right across from the Kawasaki Dealer Convention, where I'll bet they're just happy as hell to have you on board and signed up, aren't they, Bubba?
Yeah, just had to stop a little testing and come down here and check it out.
Yeah, we welcome you to the show. We're glad to have you here. Last time I interviewed you, it was about the time you made your pro debut, and you told me your goal was to break all the motocross win records, 125, 250, Supercross, Outdoor. You've done that in 125. You move to 250 next year. Is that still the primary goal? Is that the main place you're headed in your racing?
Oh, yeah, for sure. You know, I don't stop. I don't broke half of them now with the 125 record, so I shouldn't stop now. You know, I got a long career in 250s, and just really looking forward to going and getting Ricky.
If you're going to break the records, then Carmichael's the guy you got to beat. Except when he was out with a knee injury, he's won every championship he's entered since he dethroned McGrath in Supercross. You tell me about you and Ricky. How long have you known him? How has he influenced you over the years?
I've known Ricky a long time. You know, it's just been a great relationship as friends and stuff like that. And, you know, the guy's a really good rider. He's an outstanding champion and stuff like that. And, you know, it's just going to be really fun going up against him. You know, it's going to be really tough. But I think if anybody's out there, it should be me. I hope I can get in and break it.
Do you consider him a mentor? Did he help you a lot as you were both coming up? I mean, you were both Kawasaki guys, both from Florida. Did you spend much time together?
No, I think out of my, you know, 10, 15 years of racing, you know, I probably hung out with him maybe 3 weeks out of that. So, you know, the only time I really see Ricky is during the races and stuff. And, you know, the guy's a great guy. You know, I know him as a friend and as a racer, so he's a good guy to hang around.
Can you beat him? Can you beat him right out of the box? Is it going to take a while? What are you willing to do? How far out on that limb are you willing to go?
I'm willing to break that limb off. You know, I'm going to go and, you know, try to beat him as bad as I can. You know, it's going to be very tough, but, you know, I feel once I start winning, I think I get more comfortable, and, you know, hopefully I can get it. So it's just going to be tough trying to win that first race.
There's a lot of fuss about you being the first African-American superstar in motocross. It occurs to me that the real pioneer might have been your dad. Granted, it wasn't the same level you're racing now, but he was doing motocross 20 years ago when that was really unusual. Tell me how your dad and your mom prepared you for where you are today. What was your life like as a kid coming up?
Oh, you know, it was great. You know, I had a great family behind me, my mom and my dad, and now my brother. So, you know, it's been good. My dad used to be back the Willie King back in Dade City. He used to be known for breaking the back fenders off. But, you know, it's been a great career. You know, him taking me to the races and my mom being there for schooling and stuff like that. So, you know, they're back at home right now, probably watching this. So I just want to say hello to them. But, you know, I can't thank them enough. For sure, I'm here because of them.
You just signed, and this is you at Loretta Lynn. We saw a glimpse of your dad there. This is you as an amateur, and you have mentioned many times before, basically, it's the only life you've known is racing, and this is what you've been shooting for. You've just signed this new deal with Kawasaki when a lot of people were absolutely convinced Honda would throw money at you until you jumped ship. Did they make you a big offer, and why did you decide to stay where you are with the green team?
Well, with me, it's not all about money. You know, I got to be comfortable where I'm at. And, you know, I've been with Kawasaki 13 years now. So, you know, it's just a great family to be with, great surrounding of people. And I figure, you know, since it's my pro debut, you know, I need to have people I've been around with all my life. So, you know, it's just an easy decision for me to stay with Kawasaki. But, you know, they're all great. But I think Kawasaki is the place I need to be. When you think of Kawasaki, you think of Bubba. So I'm on the green team.
There you go. Loyalty pays off over the long haul. Let's go to the phones. Josh is on the line from Carson City, Nevada. Josh, you're talking to Bubba Stewart. Go ahead.
Hi, Bubba. I was wondering, how do you manage to pull off the Bubba scrub over Henry Hill and a couple of the big singles here without just totally wrecking?
I don't know. It's something I've been, you know, doing since, you know, I was little. It's just now that I took it to a different level. It's something, like, really honestly, I could not tell you. But if you really want to ask somebody, ask some of my competition. I've done it over those guys a couple times. But I honestly, if I knew how to do it, I'd have a class on it.
Just jumping over people and getting them out of the way. Well, you said one of your goals was to win a race this year by over a minute, and you won two by that margin. I mean, it's just phenomenal. Let's go to Beth in Lakeland, Florida. Beth, you're on the line with Bubba. Go ahead.
Hey, Bubba, how you doing? This is Beth down here in Lakeland.
How you doing?
Hey, all right. Hey, I just want to say congratulations on all your championships here, and make sure you tell your mom and dad I said hello, and I always appreciate that first Pee Wee Championship jersey from Loretta Lynn's.
You're welcome. You're welcome. I owe you another one. Don't worry.
Yeah, you do, bud. All right, man. Keep it up.
All right. You too. See ya.
Steve in Hilliard, Ohio. Steve, you're on with Bubba Stewart. Go ahead.
Hey, Bubba.
Hey, how you doing?
All right, man. Listen, I wanted to ask you, what's your take on the Super Motard racing since you're one of the younger guys, and do you think it's going to be around in the future?
Well, yeah, actually, people don't realize that Super Motard was here before even motocross. It was a big thing over in Europe, and, you know, it's pretty cool. You know, it's starting to get back over here and stuff, and, you know, I actually had a chance to go do it about a year ago, so I think it's cool. I actually like doing it. I kind of like riding on the street and stuff like that, so I think it'll be here for a while.
Pavement racing. There'd be a fun thing to do. We ought to talk about that. We need a commercial break before we do that. We'll do that break right now and then continue our conversation with the young man preparing, actually out testing today on the 250, getting set to move into the big leagues of motocross in 2005. Stick around. My guest is Bubba Stewart. When he won the Daytona Supercross last March, he pulled out a spray can and painted number 3 on the ground in tribute to Dale Earnhardt. A lot of people were surprised. I didn't know, Bubba, that you had an interest in car racing. Now lots of people are talking about you and car racing. How long have you paid attention to four-wheel racing? We just think of you as a two-wheel guy.
Nah, you know, I've been paying attention all my life. You know, I like four wheels and I like two wheels. You know, I just happen to be a little bit better at two wheels than four wheels. But, you know, I've just been kind of, you know, dipping my hand over in you know, something different. And, you know, it's pretty cool to be able to, you know, have people out there that kind of have an interest in me in both places. And, you know, I've just been sticking to two strokes right now, two wheels.
Two wheels. We want to know about that interest. But right now, let's go to the phones. I got Devin on the line from Daytona Beach, Florida, who may be ready to ask the key question here. I don't know. Devin, you're on with Bubba. Go ahead.
Hey, Bubba, how you doing?
I'm doing good. Hometown.
Yeah, Daytona Beach, you know, Daytona 500.
Yeah.
I had the same question as everybody else. So the rumor about you being in NASCAR, is that going to happen anytime soon?
It's kind of hard to say, you know, right now. It's, you know, I definitely do got an interest in it. I've been talking to a few people and stuff like that. But, No, it's possible, but right now I'm looking forward to, you know, my next year in 250 class and, you know, with two wheels right now. So, but I think at one time, yes, I will be in it.
I got to tell you, Bubba, you're not going to get off that early, that easy, because there's just too many rumors out there I got to ask you about. We've heard that stock car teams are calling you, that they're coming to your house to visit. There is a specific rumor, or as specific as the rumors get, that you've been offered a 10-year deal with a NASCAR team. Is there any truth to any of that? Can you tell us anything about who you're talking to and what you're talking about?
Well, you know, I could tell you one thing. There is a truth to me racing, you know, cars. There is a big truth to that. But I can't really throw out names right now. You know, it's just kind of in the stages of talking about it. But, yeah, you're pretty on it, Dave, back there. You're pretty on it.
I can't help it. It's what they pay me to do. And in my business, Bubba, you're going to get this as you go through your career. It's hard to know who to believe. I mean, I'm reading in the Orange County Register newspaper that a representative of Chip Ganassi has been at your house and that you guys have had several conversations. I talked to Chip on the phone today, and he says it's the first he's ever heard of it. So you see in my business how difficult it is to sort out the truth. I'm hoping you can help me. You know, give me a time frame. Give me a guess. I'll let you off at that. Give me your best estimate of how soon you'll be ready to make a transition to car racing.
Well, it's kind of hard to say. You know, I really have a love for two wheels right now. You know, this is my life. You know, I can't, you know, get up and drop it right now. I will tell you, it'll be within the next probably 10 to 12 years for sure. You know, I'll, you know, kind of dip my hand in and test in here now and then. But it's hard to say. Come on, you know that, Dave. You know, I'm winning everything right now, so it's kind of hard to jump out of
And you're only 18 years old. You got a guy like me wanting you to plot out your whole career. But you know what's happening. I mean, the NASCAR thing is the hottest sport in the country right now, or the hottest motorsport for sure. They have this diversity program. There are a lot of people who believe that for a kid like you, the doors of opportunity would just swing right open, and you could walk through and name your price. And I sit here saying to myself, I think this kid wants to go win all the 250 races and set all those records first. I believe him when he says that. So, but when you're 18, it's pretty tempting too. I mean, you got Michael Jordan blowing up your cell phone, and I hear you're friends with Tom Cruise. These people can be influential. And so it occurs to me to wonder, I have an email that asks, I think, an interesting question along that line. Maybe we can pop that up. It says, please ask Bubba if he would consider a move to AMA Road Racing with Michael Jordan, since Michael is expanding his racing team, or the factory Kawasaki Road Racing Team, or even MotoGP. That's how wild the rumors get. All of this, says Steve in Oakland, California, much better than NASCAR. You and Michael talk about this, or maybe you're going to get Michael down to the house and get him on the practice track. I mean, get him off those road racers.
Yeah, well, actually, one of my friends, David Vanner, actually got messing around on a motorcycle and messed up. But, you know, it's kind of hard to say. You know, I know Michael as a good friend, and you know, I haven't really asked him anything about his team and stuff like that. And, you know, for sure, you know, I like my whole life is I like to be able to do everything, you know, be able to jump in and everything. And, you know, we only live once, so, you know, it'd be nice to be able to do two wheels, four wheels, all wheels, so 6 wheels, 18 wheels, so it doesn't matter. But, you know, I'm definitely looking forward to doing all of it.
What kind of racing you watch on TV? What turns you on? What gets you excited? Do you or are you a TV race fan?
Probably IndyCar probably is my biggest one. I really like watching that. You know, it's good racing and stuff like that. And but also I like watching, you know, Supercross and stuff. You know, be able to see myself on TV, that's kind of cool. And you know, being 18, you know, being in the spotlight and watching myself on TV and, you know, doing interviews and stuff like that, it's kind of overwhelming. And you know, it's kind of hard, but it's kind of cool to be able to flip on the TV and see yourself sometimes.
Do you learn from watching yourself, and do you watch racing to analyze your competition, or are you able to do enough of that in person at the track to figure out what it takes to beat these guys? I'm thinking ahead to Carmichael. Have you studied his every move?
Well, yeah. I mean, you know, I don't want to blurt it out on TV, but yeah, I have been studying him. And, you know, I think it's going to be another guy out there, Chad Reed. You know, he's a great Supercross rider. So it's going to be me and Ricky and Chad for sure. And I've been studying all of them. I've been watching them on tapes and stuff like that. And, you know, I will be ready for sure. You know, whether it happens or not, I will be ready, though.
Let's go to John in Seattle, Washington. John, you're on with Bubba Stewart.
Hey, Bubba, how you doing?
I'm doing good. How you doing?
Good. Hey, congratulations on a near-perfect season outdoors.
Yeah, hey. pretty close.
Yeah, hey, what's your expectations for the U.S. Open next month? I know you're jumping on the 250, and it'll be a kind of a new thing for you. How's that going to go?
indoor race at the hotel out there, MGM Grand in Las Vegas. It's a big money race, your first 250 race. What's the outlook for that one?
Well, sadly, I cannot race that right now. We're just now getting the testing with the 05 bike, so you know we got a little ways to go. So you know, the bike's really good right now, but you know, I just want to be ready when I race. And my first race is January 8th, Anaheim Edison Field. So buy your tickets now. They might be sold out, but it's it's gonna be a good race. I'll tell you that much.
Attaboy, get out there and promote your future. Let me do five fast questions with Bubba here to wrap it up. Bubba, what's in the driveway? What's the four wheeler that you're driving these days?
I got a Ferrari sitting in the driveway. That's the closest thing I can get to every day.
That's not too shabby. What's in the CD player? What are you listening to?
Right now, I'm actually listening to David Banner, one of my rap friends.
Favorite racetrack?
Probably Buzz Creek, Maryland.
Who would you trade places with if you could trade places with anybody in the world?
Probably Bubba Stewart.
If I were 18 years old and had a Ferrari, I wouldn't change a thing. Last question, what is the one word that best describes Bubba Stewart?
Crazy.
Attaboy. You stay crazy and fast and having fun, and you will go far. We appreciate you taking time for us this evening. Give my regards to all those Kawasaki folks, and come on back and answer lots of questions next year when you're winning all those 250 races, okay?
Okay, I will, Dave. Thank you.
That's Bubba Stewart, ladies and gentlemen. Good fun to talk to. We appreciate his honesty. And with that, we will move on and continue right after this. I got a story I want to tell you. We'll do that right after this commercial break. It's an anniversary story. Last night we told you, tonight we show you IRL cars on a road course, conclusion of a two-day test at Homestead Miami Speedway. As you would expect, the league says the test, quote, exceeded expectations. We're going to get a first-hand report next Wednesday night. Elio Castroneves will be on the wind tunnel. Several of the drivers spoke with Robin Miller today and said that they thought the cars were fun to drive and better than they expected. I think I misspoke last night. I said Danica Patrick would test the Ray Hall IRL car there today. Actually, that happens in a private test tomorrow. Sorry about that. Now, a while back, I asked you folks to email me your favorite racing stories. We got some good stuff, and I want to do that. I want some more. I'm greedy. I'm looking for the best story you tell when you and your buddies get together and go bench racing. And in honor of an anniversary, I'm going to start the ball rolling with a story of mine, one of my favorites. It was 20 years ago, 1984. The late Ricky Graham and his Honda teammate, Bubba Schobert, battled all year for the AMA Dirt Track Championship, and going into the finale, Ricky had pulled ahead. Last race was a rain date. It was deep into the fall, cold weekend, Springfield, Illinois. I was the announcer. Graham was a shoe-in. Basically, all he had to do was not fall down, and the championship was his. Well, watch. Three laps to go. Graham led Schobert, the late Ted Booty, and Jay Springsteen across the line. A points racer would have dropped back to a safe fourth, locked up the title. He goes for the win and crashes trying to get it. He and Booty hook handlebars. Ricky went down. His title hopes apparently shattered. But wait a minute. Bike is still running. Handlebars broken. So is Ricky's arm. But he eventually picked the thing up one-handed and got it going. Up front, Schobert and Booty decide the race and, as it turned out, the championship. Schobert tried a draft pass. Couldn't get by. Booty wins. Schobert second. Then the agonizing wait. No computer scoring back then. They checked and rechecked the hand scoring. Then the announcement.
Bob Schobert finishes second. Ricky Graham finishes 13th. Ricky Graham is the national champion by one.
It was a very big deal. And yes, honey, I do love you, and I'm really happy, but it really, really hurts to try to hug you right now with this broken arm. I love dramatic championship finishes. I hate points racing. Thank you for the memory, Ricky. Did you see Kenny Roberts in that shot? Were you sharp-eyed folks? Saw KR in there? The finale of that series, by the way, is this weekend, Des Moines, DuQuoin State Fairgrounds in Illinois. It's a doubleheader weekend, and Chris Carr is odds on for the championship. My guess is he'll go for the win too. Now, Another opinion on the by the way, the whole point of that was send me your stories. Email me your great racing stories. I want to know about your favorite races. Now, another opinion on the Troubled ASA series. We discussed it here last night. The email says, Dave, I'm fortunate enough to have Hawkeye Downs Speedway, Cedar Rapids, Iowa, in my backyard. I feel the ASA National Touring Series attempted to grow its fan base when it dropped several good short track events off the schedule and added the larger tracks to the schedule. Hawkeye Downs was one. A longtime ASA fan, I loved the old series, short track, short tempers, and all attitude. We bailed on ASA. It changed. Not the fan base, says Rod S., Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Kind of a variation on what I hear from disgruntled NASCAR fans. They don't like all the changes in the series. I think it remains to be seen whether ASA can satisfy its traditional base, like this guy, and at the same time attract new fans. But their short-term problem, the immediate problem, is solving the cash flow difficulties that came about when they had a couple sponsorship deals that fell through after the new owners took over. They're trying to do that. We're putting them on TV as best we can, when we can, and when they can afford it. We'll take a break and come back.
Wind Tunnel with Dave Despain is brought to you by Taxi, starring Queen Latifah and Jimmy Fallon, October 8th, only in theaters.
Hey, this is pretty cool stuff. First live pictures of the Shanghai circuit in China, where they are getting ready to start practice for the inaugural Chinese Grand Prix, or Grand Prix of China, take your pick. Now, we are going to be going there live in about 3 hours and, I don't know, 3 or 4 minutes for the live coverage of the practice. What a facility that is. And, of course, the race schedule all weekend will be approximately the same. The practice session starting at 2 in the morning, and then tomorrow morning, if you will, at 2 in the morning, it'll be practice and qualifying, and the race starts on Sunday morning at 2 o'clock, the coverage at 1:30 in the morning, and the race at 2. Okay, exciting stuff. Last night we had a tunnelhead complaining about the victory celebrations getting out of hand. He's old school, I guess. And Jennifer Webster isn't buying a word of what that guy had to say. Jennifer says, Dave, drivers should be able to celebrate the way they want after a race victory. I liked seeing Carl Edwards celebrating by doing a backflip off his truck after the wins. I also like seeing Tyler Walker dancing and doing a headstand after his victory in Tulsa. Good luck to Casey Kane and Tyler Walker in the rest of the 04 season. Hey, why not? I mean, I cannot see the downside here. Why would you not want to watch Tyler Walker do a big celebration like this? He won his third straight USAC Silver Crown feature, 3 in a row. He's going for 4 in a row this weekend at the Four Crown Nationals. That's in Eldora Speedway, where they have all 3 USAC divisions plus the late models. And then he's going to come to the Wind Tunnel. That'll be Monday night. And maybe he's going to bring his car owner, Casey Kane, along with him. We're also going to be talking with the ARCA standout rising star Ryan Hemphill Monday. Tuesday, NHRA mega team owner Don Schumacher telling us all about the drivers he has chasing championships. Wednesday, as noted, Helio Castroneves. Thursday, your Champ Car rookie and F1 hopeful A.J. Allmendinger. That's going to be a very big week. Let's go quickly to the phones. I got Mitch in Newton Falls, Ohio. Hello, Mitch.
Yeah, Dave.
Go ahead, man.
Hey, I need you to enlighten me on something.
Okay.
Why would Roush Racing decide to run Carl Edwards and the rest of the races and use Dave Blaney as a standby with him only 39 points back from the championship?
For the
jeopardize a shot at him at getting the championship, and also going over the 7 races and jeopardize him at a chance at Rookie of the Year, well, as good as he's running so far this year.
They don't care about Rookie of the Year. They want to get him all the cup experience they can. As far as the championship, if I'm following you, they're going to keep Blaney on standby for the cup car in case he can't get back from the truck races. He is, in fact, going to run for the truck championship. That is the priority. And then if for some reason he can't get from the conflicting truck race to the cup race, that's when Blaney will drive the cup car. I think that makes a whole lot of sense myself. But anyway, obviously he disagrees. Oh, yes, it's that time of the night. Somebody informed me that that's Joe, the bartender from, I was questioning that guy, the last call guy. Somebody said it's the bartender from the Jackie Gleason show. I'm not old enough to remember that. Dawn in South Bend, Indiana, welcome to the show. Last call is all yours. What's on your mind tonight?
Thanks a lot, Dave, and thanks for Brett.